Hello, my name is Dr. Chintan Ajani, and you might be wondering that what is on your screen right now. So these are generally the expressions of the students who are attending my class. And I hope that you do not have the similar expression while attending this very important module. Friends, from the like again screen, you might be wondering that, okay, there are some formulas, so it would be definitely related to some numerics. And you are right. So we are going to discuss about one of the very important modules of your coursework, which is a statistical analysis for research. So generally, like, we often have a confusion when we are learning the statistics that, okay, we have heard about so many different kind of words like mean, median, mode, correlation, causation. Your guide might be going to tell this kind of words. So in order to get clarity, just like these two scholars, you also try to think that, okay, you may attain some of the statistical class and probably you will get more clarity whether correlation is implied to causation or not. And again, you will see that again, he came up with the same level of confusion that, okay, probably correlation is not implied to causation, but he still is not sure. So it is again the case of most of the scholars or most of the students who are pursuing the statistical course. But friends, let me assure you that if you just going to attend the statistical classes with the right approach, definitely you are going to learn a lot and able to apply right kind of statistical tools for your research and your PhD. So that is the topic of my coursework module. Me and my colleague Dr. Priyanshu Rathod will going to just help you out in learning statistical analysis for research. So let's begin. So what you are going to learn in this video, so these are the some of the topics which you are going to learn. We are going to just have a glimpse that what do we mean by statistics, why it is important for you to learn statistics as a researcher, what common mistakes was done by novice researchers or the beginners, what process to follow while doing a statistical analysis for research, and we are also going to learn about levels of measurement of data in this video. So let's start with what do we mean by statistics. So when we came across the word statistics, you might recall something from your graduation or post-graduation, some of the topics like mode, mean, median, standard deviation, some hypothesis testing kind of a stuff. So friends, definitely statistics is a branch of mathematics. Till 1980s, it was a part of mathematics. Then probably it has been evolved as a separate branch of a study. Yes, definitely it deals with specs and figures. So when your boss asks you statistics, he generally refers to present some of the facts and figures for the report which you are planning to prepare or for the particular research which you are undertaking. Yes, some of you it might be just only mean, median, mode or standard deviation or some of the descriptive measures which you used for your analysis or research. For some of you, it might be the type of distributions which you use to analyze the data. Like you might have learned about the binomial distribution or maybe Poisson distribution or maybe a normal distribution or uniform distribution. So for some of you, it might be statistics is just synonyms to type of distribution. Majority of you might be thinking that it's all about estimation and hypothesis testing. There are some assumptions which we need to check whether they are true or false, right? But friends, the more scientific definition of statistics, in my opinion, statistics is a science of four activities, which is gathering, analyzing, interpreting, and presenting the data. So first is like how we need to collect the data. Once we finish with the collection of the data, how we analyze the data in order to identify that what kind of statistical tool or applications we can adopt for this particular type of data. Once we have an outcome of the statistical analysis, then we need to learn how to interpret that outcome, right, or output of the statistical analysis. And last, how we can present it in order to have some meaningful conclusion. So this is like about statistics in my words. So now let's go ahead and try to learn that why it is important to learn statistics as a researcher. First and foremost, statistical knowledge will definitely going to help you to use proper methods for all the four things which we have just described in the definition. That means to collect the data, employ the correct analysis, and effectively presents the results. In order to have these things, you must know some of the statistical tools and techniques. Second, there is a growing importance of making the decisions or opinion based on data. So for that, it is a crucial that you can critically assess the quality of analysis that others are presenting to you, right? So it might be possible that some of your students, or when down the line when you worked in a very senior position, so people often going to represent you some of the data. So in order to interpret, like again, if and do not be like a dumb terminal, we must know that how to interpret some of the statistical outcomes. And for that, I think that it is very important to learn the statistics as a researcher. Third, to develop an ability to extract meaning from the journal articles, right? Because in your throughout the journey of your PhD, you are often going to refer to many journal articles for your review of literature. But again, from that particular conclusion which a researcher has made for their papers, what things you can extract, what meaningful information you can extract, you must have a knowledge of statistics. And to develop an ability to critically evaluate research from the statistical perspective. So there are many perspectives of a research. One is like definitely very important perspective is a statistical perspective, that how you can interpret that numbers in order to identify a meaningful information. So that's why, like, again, we need to learn a statistics as a researcher. Next is like to definitely develop a critical analytical thinking, which is one of the most touted skills in the 21st century for a researcher or for an academician or even for a corporate people. Next, to use numbers also provides you an air of credibility for the scientific studies. Like when you are supporting your claims with the help of numbers, right? It will give you more credibility, right? That, okay, so he's just not giving his opinion, but again, he has some numbers to support his claim. And that's why, like, if you do not know the statistics, you may not going to deal with the numbers. You may not able to identify that how to make a meaningful conclusion out of that numbers. And definitely, friends, if you give some numbers to support your claim, it will definitely going to give you a better credibility in the market. And last, to communicate your findings effectively. So these are the few of the reasons that why you need to learn the statistics as a researcher. But friends, during this journey, or during this journey of statistical analysis and presenting the data, most of the time we are seeing that researchers are making many mistakes, right? So in the next slide, I'm going to summarize that what are the common mistakes or error done by the novice researcher, which you can keep in mind and try to avoid while pursuing your research. First mistake, which I often seen, right, which a researcher or a beginner used to make, is error in identifying correct level of measurement of data. So if there are some numbers, it doesn't mean that you can directly apply all kind of test on that number. First, we need to identify that what kind of measurement is of data that number represents. For example, it might be possible that data is a categorical data. You have just taken a ranking kind of a stuff, or you have taken a rating of a, like a satisfaction level of a customers or satisfaction level of the patients or so on. So you cannot directly apply a parametric test on that numbers, right? So first and foremost step, whenever we came across a number, we need to identify that what is the level of measurement of that particular data. That we are going to learn in this particular slide, that how we can know that what is the level of measurement of the data. And that is the basic thing which we need to learn and try to avoid, that we should not fall the prey of making this mistake. Second is use the wrong statistical test. So again, people often used to think that, okay, whenever there are some numbers, we can directly apply all the tests on all the data. No, that is a wrong assumption. Even there are quantitative data, like for example, height or weight of the patients as well, which are quantitative data, you cannot directly apply the parametric test on that, right? There are certain assumptions, right, for using the parametric test or non-parametric test. So as a researcher, and especially the scholars, PhD scholars, first you need to validate that assumption, right? That whether this data is fit for utilizing that for parametric test or not. So do not make this mistake of using a wrong statistical test without validating its assumption. Third is like use summary measures inappropriately. Many times we have a tendency to use a very limited kind of a measures so that we are getting a desired outcome. Probably like when you have a entire analysis with you, like you have a measures of central tendency like mean and median with you, you have a measures of variability like standard deviation and variance with you, you have measures of shape with you like skewness and kurtosis, but still you try to hide some information or try to manipulate the data by representing a limited information, right? And try to use or summarize a measures just as per your convenience of research. So do not do that, right? To reaching at a conclusion only by taking means or measures of central tendency is the biggest error which you are making. Always try to consider standard deviation or variability so that you will be able to better interpret the output and make some meaningful conclusion. So do not use the limited measures. Try to just have a holistic view, right? By reviewing all kind of measures, measures of central tendency along with measures of variability and shape, and then make some conclusion to for the data which you are dealing with. Fourth mistake which you often see is like presentation of a categorical data as a quantitative data and use it for the further analysis. As I mentioned it, that you are just taking the rating or a ranking scale and trying to just capture the data from the respondents. And then once you have a data, you assume that, okay, the rating or categorical kind of a data is as good as the quantitative data. And let me apply some of the metric or parametric test on that. Please do not do that. Presentation of categorical data as a quantitative data is the biggest mistake which you can do and which you can avoid while doing the research. Next one is inappropriate treatment of the outliers and the reporting. So many times we are seeing that outliers are very significant in the research. It is a compulsory or mandatory to find the outliers and report that outliers, because outlier can lead you to some of the, like, again, altogether different findings from your research. But we are in a hurry to conclude our research, and that's why, like, we have a tendency that we used to ignore the outliers, right? So that is an inappropriate treatment which you are giving to the outliers. Please avoid making such kind of a mistake and do not ignore the outliers. Try to interpret that why that thing has been happened, and that may lead you to altogether different findings as well. Another common mistake which I have we have interpreted in the beginning slide is like incorrect interpretation of result, just like correlation and causation. We generally have a tendency that we used to say that, okay, correlation is equal to causation, which is absolutely wrong, right? If we randomly select any two variables, like what is the run scored by the Virat Kohli and the sales of automobile cars, we are definitely going to find some correlation even for us two random variables. But if I will say that because Virat Kohli has made some runs, that's why there is a sales of automobile car, it will be a false causation which I am applying, right? So do not make an error to do the misrepresentation of a data or incorrect interpretation of the results, just like what I mentioned here, correlation and causation. Another mistake which people used to make is incorrect extrapolation. They are tempted to draw a conclusion beyond what actually data is representing. The sample size is very, very small and a biased one, representing a limited geographical region. But they are trying to extrapolate it, their conclusion, for entire India or maybe for entire continent as well, right? In every research, there is a scope, and we need to play or make conclusion within that limited boundary or scope which we have defined for our research. Don't try to extrapolate your outcomes or generalize your outcomes to beyond your scope, right? So please try to have limitations of your research. And do not try to make unnecessary extrapolation of your outcomes and generalize, make some generalized statement. Try to avoid this kind of an error. Another error which I have seen is, like, again, statistical significance can be mistaken as a clinical significance. It might be possible that many times you may see that your hypothesis has been statistically rejected. But if you see on a substantial part, it doesn't make a larger difference to the outcome of or a larger implication in our business or outcome in the research, right? So we always need to apply a brain that, okay, this data is statistically significant, but again, it has some also a clinical significance or implication in the business or not before making a conclusion on a data. So these are some of the common mistakes which researcher used to make. Then there are many more, but I have just tried to summarize the most frequent mistakes which was done by the beginners or novice researcher. And I'm very sure that all of you, during your journey of your PhD or research, you try to avoid these mistakes. So now let's move ahead and try to know that what steps we need to follow while doing a statistical analysis in order to avoid making such kind of a mistakes. So first and foremost step, what we need to do is like we need to identify the level of measurement of data. Whenever we came across any of the number or any of the variable, first we need to check that what is the level of measurement of the data. There are various measurement levels, like it can be a nominal, it can be ordinal, it can be interval, ratio, that we are going to learn in a couple of minutes. Once we know the level of measurement of data, next task what we need to do is to check the objective of doing a statistical analysis. So next we need to check about the objective of doing a statistical analysis. So what is your objective of doing analysis? Whether you want to use the data which you have collected to describe the characteristic of the subject or phenomena which you are studying right now, and to make some conclusion by describing the characteristic of a subject, or you want to utilize the data which you have collected to test some assumptions or hypotheses and make some inferences out of that, or to make some generalized statement out of that, or you want to utilize the data which you have collected to make some predictions or to develop altogether a new model, right? So what is the objective of doing the statistical analysis? Second step, you need to clarify with your objective. Once you are clear with the what level of measurement of the data which you have collected, second, you are clear with the objective of doing a statistical analysis. Third step is to select the right statistical tool or technique which is suitable with the data which you have collected. Once you have done with the statistical analysis, right? Last is, once you get the outcome from the software, you must know how to interpret the result and derive the meaningful conclusion. So let's start with the levels of measurement of the data. So friends, like again, let me show you the two numbers and just try to think that what these two numbers represents. There are two numbers on my screen right now, 10 and 40. This 10 can be a Chelsea number of Sachin Tendulkar or Lionel Messi. Same way, 40 can be my roll number. 10 can be number of points in my pocket. 40 is the percentage of increment which I get on my salary. Or this 10 can be like again a weight of a newborn baby. A 40 can be again, let's say, the profit in crores of a particular company. So this 10 and 40, the same numbers, can have different meanings. But can we say that, okay, we can apply the same kind of a treatment when we say that it is a jersey number or a roll number, and when we say that it is a profit of a company? Obviously not. So that's what we are planning to learn in this particular video, that what are different levels of measurement and how a statistical application or analysis differs with the type of the data or levels of measurement of a data. So basically there are four levels of measurement, which are nominal, ordinal, interval and ratio. Nominal being the lowest level of measurement and ratio being the highest level of measurement. Let us understand each of them step by step with some examples. So first level of measurement is nominal, right? Generally the nominal type of a data are used for the purpose of identification or classification or categorization. For example, our roll number. There is no other use of that number other than identification, right? Second, we can take example of gender. We can just classify the data based on like the gender, like male or female, or maybe like again our caste, or maybe our the category, right? So the sole purpose is to classify the people on the basis of the data which we have collected. Another example, like again, is like our bank account number. It doesn't mean that, okay, this much amount I have in my bank account. It just represents that this is just a unique number to identify the bank account number. You can now recall many of the examples which are a nominal type of data. For example, your PAN card number, your vehicle registration number, your mobile number. Again, that is nothing but a kind of a data which is called nominal type of data. Here, the purpose is identification, classification, or categorization. But the biggest limitation of nominal kind of data is that relative magnitude of number is not meaningful. What I mean to say is, like, suppose if there is a one student with roll number 12 and another student with roll number 25, I cannot say that, okay, the roll number 12 are higher in competency as compared to roll number 25, right? Same way in bank account, the number doesn't represent the amount which I have in my bank account, right? So relative magnitude, or in short, numbers does not have meaning when we deal with the nominal kind of a data. So that limitation has been like addressed in the second level of data, which is called ordinal level of data, where the numbers have some meaning now, right? So best examples of ordinal data is numbers which used to indicate rank or order. Generally in competitions, when we say that he stood second rank and another student's fifth rank, now we have the meaning that, okay, the person who have secured the second rank is little bit or much more higher in competency as compared to student who secured fifth rank or tenth rank. So now the relative magnitude of the numbers have some meaning, right? Examples are ranking productivity of employees, like we can rank some of the employees first, second, third on the basis of productivity, and that have some meaning as well. Another example which you can take is rating. When we are participating in different kind of surveys, they are often ask us to rate out of 1 to 10 or 1 to 5, where 1 is the lowest rating and 10 is the highest rating. So suppose if I have given 8 and another person has given 4, now that numbers have some meaning that I am a little bit more satisfied as compared to the person who has rated 4. But again, in ordinal level of data, there is a limitation, right? That difference between the two numbers are not comparable. What I mean to say is, I cannot say that the student who has secured second rank and student who has secured third rank, the difference between of marks between the two students is equal. Or I cannot say that if I have rated 8 and I have rated 4, then there is equal level of satisfaction or dissatisfaction among us, right? So the difference between two numbers are not comparable. That is the limitation of the ordinal level of a data. And friends, nominal and ordinal are both are generally called non-metric data and generally used to measure qualitative data like gender, or maybe you can say category, caste, or we have seen that roll number or the ranks, or maybe the rating in the survey, different kind of surveys. So both are generally termed as a qualitative or non-metric type of data. Now the limitation of ordinal data, that means difference between two numbers are not comparable or not equal, will be addressed in next level of measurement, which is the interval level of data. Now, in interval level of data, two numbers have some meaning and the relative magnitude is comparable because the distance between the two numbers are now equal. We will take some examples to better understand that how distance between two consecutive integers are equal and are comparable in nature. Let's say calendar time. When I say 2 days from now, and let's assume that today is 20th of the month. So 2 days from now, so now you will say that, okay, sir is talking about 22nd, right? Because in each day there are 24 hours, right? So you assume that there will be total 24 hours in each day, and that's how your calculator add in that particular number. Same way, suppose if I say that 3 hours from now, let's assume that right now it is 8 o'clock of morning, then you will say that, okay, we have fixed a meeting at 11 o'clock. So you have done some addition by fixing 0 and 8, 8 plus 3 equals to 11. Same way, temperature of a room is also an example of interval kind of a data, growth rates. For example, a company have a sales of, let's say, 200 crore. And now they are saying that we have increased our sales by 10%. So if they have achieved 200 crore, then we may say that, okay, there is 0% increase in sales. But when they say that we have increase of 10%, that means 10% of 200 is 20 crores. That means the total sales is 220 crores, right? Where 1% equals to 2 crores, right? So growth rate, calendar time, Fahrenheit temperature, all are examples of what kind of a data, interval level of data. But again, if you have observed in all these examples, that location of the zero which I have taken is arbitrary. For example, when I calculated the growth rate, I have fixed the zero at 200. When I have said that 3 hours from now, I have done the addition by fixing the zero at 8. When I said that 2 days after today, that means I fixed a zero at 20th of the month. So that means location of zero is not a natural zero, but arbitrary. I'm changing the location of zero to make some calculations, right? So that is the limitation of interval level of data. But again, you need to note that the difference between two numbers are equal, because each hour has 60 minutes, each day has 24 hours. And each person means, in my example, 200 crore, each person are equal to 2 crores, right? So the limitation of interval level of data will be removed in the last or highest level of measurement, which is called ratio level of data, which is the highest level of measurement. And the location of origin or zero is absolute, that means a natural zero, right? Let us take some examples in order to better understand that, like height. When we measure our height, we are always starting from the natural zero. Weight, we cannot say that, okay, last year my weight is 70 kg, now I have just, my weight is just 2 kg because I increased by 2 kg. No, we are always calculating it from the natural zero. Same way, volume, profit or loss which a company incurs each year's, revenue, expenses, all these are examples of ratio level of our data. So friends, interval and ratio are generally called metric data or quantitative data, because generally it are measured and in numbers, right? So this is a summary of all the four levels of data which we have learned: nominal, ordinal, interval and ratio. Nominal data is generally used for the purpose of identification, classification or counting. Ordinal, we can definitely have all of the above, that means what we can do in nominal data plus ranking. In interval, we can able to perform all kind of mathematical operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication and division, because that is a metric kind of a data. But the zero is not fixed or it is arbitrary in nature. In ratio, we can do all of the above, right? And the zero is also a natural zero. So generally, we can think from the statistical perspective, then we can apply majorly we can apply non-parametric test for nominal or ordinal kind of a data which are qualitative in nature, and we can apply parametric tests for interval and ratio kind of a data which is quantitative in nature, right? So I hope that levels of measurement is clear to everyone. So let us try to identify quickly that whether you understood or not. For example, rank, you need to identify what type of data it is. I will give you just 1 second. You can think, and probably I will definitely going to answer because it is a recorded video. Ranking of a country based on number of tests done by the COVID-19 patient, that how many tests country are doing on each day, on the basis of that we have given a ranks. So definitely ranking means ordinal type of data. I hope that you also identified it correctly. Let's go with the second one. Total number of new cases of COVID-19 patients on 17th August 2020 in Rajkot. How many new cases? So again, every day we are just resetting the number of cases to zero and then we are counting. So it is a quantitative data and the zero is natural zero. So that this type of data will be a ratio kind of a data. Medicare policy number of a patient. Again, it can be of 8 digit, it can be of 6 digit, it can be of 2 digit. But it does not have any other purpose rather than identifying the patient. So definitely it is a nominal kind of a data. Total number of deaths recorded in a particular day. Again, when we say a particular day, again, we are resetting our numbers to a natural zero. And then we are calculating how many deaths occurred because of COVID on each day. So again, this is an example of ratio kind of a data. Rate of increase of COVID-19 patients in Gujarat state. Now, when we are calculating rate, we are taking a base, a previous day or maybe a previous month or a previous week. So again, the zero is not a natural zero, but again, the data which we are referring, right? So the base can be a weekly data, a base can be a monthly data, or a base can be a just a previous day. So this is definitely an example of interval data. Rating of hygiene and cleanliness of COVID-19 dedicated hospital. Again, rating means it is a kind of a data which is called ordinal kind of data. Date on which Mr. Ajay will complete his quarantine period. The day on which he detected positive. Again, we are going to at 14 from that date. So again, we are not taking a natural zero. We are fixing an arbitrary zero to make some calculation. So it is an example of interval data. So I hope that with these examples, you are very much clear. The last one is gender of a COVID-19 patient. We just classify the patients on the basis of gender. So again, there is no other use of capturing the data, or we cannot perform any mathematical operations on that. So that is an example of a nominal kind of data. So with these examples, you will get more clarity about types of data or level of measurement. I hope that you have understood this very first important step of statistical analysis. Still you have query on this, you can definitely drop an email to my email ID, which is chinchan.rajani@rq.ac.in. Thank you very much. Again, we will go ahead with the next video where we are going to learn with different kind of types of statistics. Thank you.